Take your Bible, go to Philippians chapter 2. Philippians chapter 2. Appreciate the testimonies. It was a privilege for Susan and I to be here for the occasion, and not just Brother Bob turning 60. I just got one thing to say about that. Don't blink. You might as well try to get a good deal on the 70 napkins now. Because, I mean, it goes fast. Amen? I do appreciate the testimonies that were given. So, again, his birthday, that's cool. But to be able to be with this church family as you assembled, fellowshiped, and rallied around your pastor, said some really nice things. Very serious things. Let me just say to you, Pastor, don't let it go to your head. But the Bible says, well, I'm going to say, the most important factor in becoming a good leader is to become a good follower. Now, I say that not because Brother Grissom was an assistant for 20 years, and certainly that shows that that's why he was able to step into this place. But Jesus Christ, the greatest leader, here's what I want to say. The greatest leader that ever lived, the one that said, follow me and I'll make thee fishers of men, was the greatest follower that ever lived. Because on the eve of his crucifixion, he said, nevertheless, not what I will. That's what makes a leader. And until you become a good follower, it doesn't matter how much you know, doesn't matter what you've done, you have to learn to be a good follower. That's the Bible principle. I just want to read a verse out of Philippians chapter 2. And when I think about your pastor, it says, Paul writes, and we have sent with him our brother, which we have oftentimes proved diligent in many things. No, that's not what I want to read. That's the text. I'm sorry. Everybody turn to where I said, except the evangelist. That's the way it goes. All right, Philippians chapter 2 and verse 25. Here's the verse. Yet I suppose it necessary to send to you Epaphroditus, my brother and companion in labor and fellow soldier, but your messenger, and he that ministered to my wants. I preached a message out of that text at Blessed Hope a couple of weeks ago, and I'm not preaching it again tonight. But when I look at that verse and I think about your pastor, I see that, those attributes in Brother Bob. He's a brother and a good example for the rest of us. He's a companion in labor. You know, a good leader doesn't send anybody anywhere they wouldn't go themselves. That's the example the Lord set. And we saw that testified to today in Brother Grissom's leadership of this church. He leads from the front. And it said, fellow soldier. And when he came over to me while I was signing a rock, don't be throwing that through nobody's windshield. I can't even believe I fell for that. One of you is back there going, And which one do I want through the mayor's window? But I thanked him as he came over for being a fellow soldier. Amen. Because ever since we've known each other, and I didn't get to know him very well at Blessed Hope because he was always working. Amen. So what he was doing, most of it wasn't when I was around. But I knew early on we were dedicated to the cause of Jesus Christ, and the fruit is sitting here right now. Amen. So I appreciate that about you. That's high ground to be a brother and a companion of labor and a fellow soldier. Thank you for being that for me. And it said, but your messenger. And boy, that's the high calling of God in Christ Jesus right there. So that's enough about him. Go to 2 Corinthians chapter 8. 2 Corinthians chapter 8. And I will say this, because I've been coming to this church for I don't know how many years. a number of years when your previous pastor decided to go to Connecticut. How could that be in the will of God? To leave Minnesota to go to Connecticut? I've been to Connecticut. Believe me, stay here. No, I'm kidding about that. But I was really relieved to find out that the man that assumed the leadership here was somebody I knew. Because, you know, pastors change, and a lot of times then their ideas and their friends change. And, boy, I was pretty sure Brother Kristen was going to let me keep coming, and I'm glad you did. Because look at what God is doing here. Look at what God's done. Look at these kids. They're little bitty kids. I'll come back soon and they'll all have mustaches. Not the girls. Not the girls. 2 Corinthians. Come on, move on. 2 Corinthians chapter 8. Is that what I said? Have I ever said that? I'm confused. Amen. Listen, churches should follow the rescue mission formula. You do the preaching, then you feed them. You don't eat first. I'm glad you guys stayed because I thought half these people are going to leave. I told some, we let the air out of your tires. And they went, oh, wait a minute. He might have. 2 Corinthians chapter 8. And let's begin reading in verse 16. It says, "But thanks be to God, which put the same earnest care into the heart of Titus for you, same earnest care as Paul had to this church in Corinth." And it said in verse 17, "For indeed he accepted the exhortation, but being more forward, of his own accord, he went unto you." And that's the evidence of a true burden. It's more than a job. Amen. And it says, verse 18, "And we have sent with him the brother, whose praise is in the gospel throughout all the churches, and not that only, but who was also chosen of the churches to travel with us with this grace, which is administered by us to the glory of the same Lord and declaration of your ready mind." I want to preach about this guy that is not named. He's referred to as the brother. So, but there's definitely some information, important information about him, and we're gonna bring some of that out. That's what we're gonna preach on. Father, again, we come to you in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Help my mind think right, and it only happens when you help, and I thank you for it. Help us all pay attention with food digesting and things that we think kids have been playing. I get all that. Help me just say something that you'd be pleased with, might matter, and pray that the Spirit of God bear witness to anybody in here that's not saved. And just thank you for giving us a place to meet, and Lord, I would be remiss if I didn't thank you for putting us in a country that allows us to gather freely like this. Forgive us for taking it for granted, and which we all have. And that's evidence when we complain about things just shows how not thankful we really are. Help us to be more so. Help us to get something out of this little message tonight, and I'll thank you for it in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, so we've got a fellow here that Paul thought highly of, obviously. He sent him with Titus to this church that he cared about, and the first thing we know about him is he's a brother. He's a brother in Christ. He's a believer. Amen. If you're staying here tonight, then we're brothers and sisters in Christ. Amen. We could be from different parts of the country, have a lot of different thoughts, ideas, likes, dislikes in a lot of areas. But because of the blood of Christ, we're in the family of God. That ought to mean more than our little differences of opinion. It ought to. Amen. Okay, and so it says then, and we said within the brother, verse 18, and then it goes on and says this. And it gets real serious as far as I'm concerned, whose praise is in the gospel throughout all the churches. Amen. In other words, that is the testimony you want to have. That your praise, what you're known for is the gospel of Jesus Christ. It says in 1 Corinthians 8 and verse 3, "But if any man love God, the same is known of him." It's all right to like different things. It's okay to be good at different things. But at the end of the day, child of God, your primary testimony ought to be in a lost and dying world, at school, at work, in the neighborhood, at the family reunion. Your primary testimony ought to be that you love God. And if you ever get to that point, it will become what you're known for. This guy, I don't know his name, but his praise is in the gospel throughout all the churches. Let me ask you something tonight. What's your praise in? Again, it's okay to excel in different things, but does anybody know you're Christian outside of this room right now? Amen. Does anybody know you're a Christian except for your cars in the parking lot of a church a time or two a week? Millions of Americans go to church every week. We're not making a dent in this Laodicean age. Amen. All right, so verse 19, it says, and not that only, but who was chosen of the churches to travel with us, with this grace which is administered by us to the glory of the same Lord and declaration of your ready mind. He was chosen by the churches to be a faithful traveling companion of Paul and Titus, Timothy, whoever it was, whatever period. And let me just say this. We know something about traveling. We've been on the road over 25 years. Now, we do own a home. I'm pretty sure. It was there last time we were in Ohio. Amen. But for the last 25 years, primarily, we have spent more time on the road in a motor home. It is not a recreational vehicle. We are not on vacation. We had an extra week between meetings one time, and we're closer to home, which is Ohio. And I asked my wife, I says, hey, we got a couple days. Where do you want to go? She looked at me. She never flinched. She said, home. Take me somewhere that isn't moving, that isn't vibrating all the time. We're doing what we do because God called us to do this, and we don't apologize for loving our job, and we got the best job in the world. Amen. But the road is maybe a little tougher than some people would understand, and I just want to say it's hard enough as it is with all the things, but let alone if you're traveling with a whiner or a complainer. And evidently, this fella, this brother, he's got a good testimony in all the churches and was chosen to travel with the Apostle Paul. Now, when I started giving my testimony, I spent the first year on bond. Then I got sentenced to 1,000 hours community service by a federal judge. The federal judge was a Democrat appointed by Jimmy Carter. And come on, not tonight. And he's a full-blooded Jew. Got a comment on that? All right. So this is a Democrat, Jewish, federal judge, 22 years on the bench when I stepped into the courtroom. And that guy said, Mr. Spurgeon, I want you to tell the court what happened to you to account for the letters and all the people in the... And the audience was like 80 people from church came to my sentencing. He said, I want you to tell me what happened to you on the inside. He said the word inside. To account for the most exemplary pre-sentence investigation I've seen in 22 years. Now, you know, listen, I got experience at this. When you go before a judge, you pay this lawyer guy and he does all the talking. And this judge isn't talking to the lawyer. This judge is talking to me directly. And I'm not prepared for this. Amen. So I leaned forward to the microphone, and he's saying, what happened to you? And I said, I got saved. And I stepped back. That's all. That is the explanation. Amen. And he said, could you elaborate on that a little bit for the record? And they're taking notes. And I got the transcript from that day. And it's like, I don't know, 50 pages. And I said, yes, Your Honor. Last year, up in cell 2 across the street in federal holding, I asked Jesus, or I repented of my sin, and I asked Jesus Christ to be my Savior. And I said, he changed my heart. And I stepped back, and that was that. That is What happened to me? That judge took a few minutes to read through all the reasons he was going to depart from the congressional sentencing guidelines and said this. He said, Mr. Spurgeon, I believe you have a message that people need to hear, especially young people, and I'd send you to 1,000 hours community service telling other people how you got off liquor, how you got off drugs, and how you got out of a criminal lifestyle. And I'm going, did he just sentence me to preach the gospel of Jesus Christ? And he did. And here I'm a brand new Christian. I've been saved like 1 year, and I'm going, wow, this Christian thing's cool. I should have done this earlier. And so then doors started opening, prisons and juvenile detention centers and all kinds of different churches. And my pastor had enough sense to get a couple guys to travel with me. Amen. And always had at least one guy, and I'd been all over from Ohio all the way to Florida, all up on the East Coast. And I've been all up and down there giving my testimony in churches. And the preacher, I always had somebody with me. The preacher said, the Bible says this, Ecclesiastes 4 and verse 7, two are better than one because they have a good reward for their labor. I was a brand new Christian. He didn't know me that well. He knew what God had done. He had a better understanding of what God had just done than I did. And here I'm going to go, okay, I'll brag on Jesus Christ. And he knew as a young Christian that I just might get tempted in a way that I wasn't ready to resist. So he sent, always had somebody with me, usually two guys, and we just drove around the country. We were all pretty young Christians, but we all were trying to hold each other's feet to the fire, keep us from getting in trouble. He said this, a second witness when these churches you go to will keep anybody from being able to say, you said something you didn't say, you did something you didn't do. And this is before texting and cell phone cameras and social media. How much more is important to keep your guard up? Amen. Because people can say, you said anything. You better be careful. Amen. So I run around doing that for a while. And praise the Lord. I did 1,100 hours community service in those 5 years. They said, well, you only had 1,000. I said, I did an extra 100 for the judge. We printed that track, and it's been printed in English over 5 million times and in 7 other languages. And the very first one that rolled off the press in August of 1992, I sent right to the federal building to Judge Rice. I hope he gets saved. He acts more saved than some Christians I know. I hope he is. Amen. God sure used him to be a blessing to me. I know something about traveling, 1,000 hours. People said, well, what's Spurgeon going to do when he gets off of probation, when he's not worried about going to prison, like I'm afraid of prison? I got more friends behind bars than most of you got on the outside. I did not become a Christian because I was afraid of going to prison. I became a Christian because I was afraid of going to hell, and I ain't ashamed to say that to nobody. Amen. 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 They said, law enforcement, people on the street, and even some church people, I found out later, were just waiting for this 5 years to run out to see what Spurgeon was going to do when he didn't have to go to church every week. So you know what Spurgeon did? He went full-time into evangelism. That was 26 and a half years ago. I've been doing what that judge told me in 1991 ever since, just bragging on Jesus Christ. What a ride. Amen. We know something about traveling. Verse 22. And we have sent with them our brother, whom we have, look what it says, whom we have oftentimes proved diligent in many things, but now much more diligent. This guy's not got a great testimony in all the churches. He's being recommended to go on the road because there are different scenarios, different temptations, different things going on out there. And this guy has been chosen, amen, worthy to handle that. And now it says in verse 22 that he's proved diligent. Now, if you're called of God, praise the Lord. And if you are called, the first thing you're called to do is learn the book. Because people don't need to know what you think. Even if you're saved, they need to know what God says. Yeah. Amen. So if you're called, good. And if you're schooled, good. But after that, before you're ready for service, you have to be proved. Amen. Bible says this in 1 Peter chapter 4 and verse 12. Beloved, think it not strange concerning the fiery trial which is to try you, as though some strange thing happened unto you. I mean, I hear Christians, seasoned Christians, I can't believe it happened to me. Let me tell you something, friend. It ain't God's fault. There's a reason. Figure it out. Maybe he's just seeing what you're made of. Amen. It says in verse 13 there in 1 Peter 4, but rejoice inasmuch as ye are partakers in Christ's sufferings, that even when his glory shall be revealed, ye may be glad also with exceeding joy. This thing is far, I hate to say it or think it, and I hope I'm wrong, but it's not over. It's maybe far from over. All I know is we need to stay in the fight. Trials prove you. That's what they test, what you're made of. Bob Jones Sr. said many years ago, the true test of a man's character is what it takes to make him quit. And I heard that 25 years ago, and I thought, yep, that's deep. This is an old man of God. I don't have any reason to doubt that. I can see that. And now 25 years later, I can look back. And I can see people that are not, that have quit, that I never dreamed would. They never dreamed they would. You got to be proved. Amen. This brother had been tried. This brother had weathered some storms, endured some trials, and his testimony here is that he's proven diligent and many things. And I'm reading through that. I'm going, man, that's high ground. What's his name? And we don't get his name. I figured out who it is later from another passage. But when I read it, this is what I thought of. The Bible says in 2 Timothy chapter 4 and verse 3, thou therefore endure hardness as a good soldier of Jesus Christ, no man that warreth entangle himself in the affairs of this life, that he may please him who had chosen him to be a soldier. In my opinion, this guy's definitely a soldier, but what? We don't know his name. So, you ready for the title? Unknown soldier. That's what I call this guy. I call him an unknown soldier. Now, that didn't go over very well, but I don't care. We visit the Tomb of the Unknowns in Washington, D.C. at Arlington National Cemetery when we're over that way. And I'll give you some background on that. Until 1998, the tomb contained the remains of four American soldiers, one from World War I, World War II, Korea, and Vietnam. And then in 1998, the Vietnam vet was identified and reburied by his family with full military honors, and the Vietnam part of the crypt remains empty to this day as a reminder of the many missing in action. Amen. It says on the tomb, here rests an honored glory, an American soldier known but to God. Amen. That sentinel walks that post 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, and has since something like 1937, I'm not sure, and rain or shine. And there was one, a couple years ago, it was a story about a tornado? Something like that. I don't think it was a hurricane, but it went through there, and there's a picture, and that guy's walking his post when everybody, I mean, the president's been evacuated, and everybody else in Washington has been told to hunker down, and that tomb did not stand without a sentinel on it. That's the kind of stuff that stirs me up. Amen. So here's the Sentinel's Creed. Now think about this. I think about this, the Ranger Creed, the Marine Corps Creed, things like that, and the things that are being said by these men that, I mean, should be able to be said, no-brainer, by you, child of God. The Sentinel's Creed goes like this. My dedication to this sacred duty is total and wholehearted. With dignity and perseverance, my standard will remain perfection. Through the years of diligence and praise and the discomfort of the elements, I will walk my tour in humble reverence to the best of my ability. Man, if we could get a hold of that in our service to Jesus Christ, we'd make a little more of a difference. Amen. Even in the age we live in. Amen. It says this in Romans 13 and verse 7, render therefore to all their dues, tribute to whom tribute is due, custom to whom custom, fear to whom fear, honor to whom honor. What you saw this afternoon was a little example of giving honor to whom honor unto whom honor was due, as you recognized your pastor, and just, you know, that's scriptural. I want to use this message tonight, Unknown Soldier, and I want to give honor to whom honor's due, because there's some unknown soldiers in the cause for Jesus Christ, and they're going to get recognized tonight. 1 Timothy, go to 1 Timothy chapter 2. 1 Timothy chapter 2 and verse number 1. And the Bible says this, I exhort therefore that first of all, how many ever heard the expression, first things first? Well, there you go. First of all, supplications, prayers, intercessions, and giving of thanks be made for all men. Now, Paul is training his son in the Lord, his successor, and he's expounding on the importance of prayer. Amen. Now, let me tell you this tonight, all over the country, and there are some unknown soldiers in the body of Christ, and they're prayer warriors. Amen. Let me say, if you're a prayer warrior, thank you. Amen. I had a lady, an elderly lady in a church one time we went through, and she said, Brother Spurgeon, I wish I could help you and your family on the road. And I think we even had kids back then. And she said, I wish I could help you. She's a senior citizen. She's on fixed income. She's talking about money. And she said this, but all I can do is pray. Amen. And it hit me like a ton of bricks. Yeah. Nobody can do more. Then prayers get through to the throne of God. Amen. $1 million I'd have to pay tax on. You follow me? Money goes, man. And not as far as it used to, but if you can sincerely get a hold of the throne of grace on our behalf, amen. Thank God for prayer warriors. And in 03, we're in Amarillo, Texas. We got just a little west of Texas, west of Amarillo, and Compressor Blue on that Greyhound bus we used to have, pulled over, and ended up 6-7 hour ordeal getting towed back to Amarillo, where I had a bus garage at midnight. The tow truck driver is unhooking this bus. The tow truck was as big as a bus. And the guy was having a hard time. It was dark. It was late. And he had the bus up on blocks so that he could adjust the mechanism from this big tow truck. And he asked me if I could help him. And I laid down between the truck and the bus with a flashlight to help him, tell him how to move the mechanism. And I'm laying down there. I was not under the bus. The bus is up on wheels, but there's no air. And so you don't understand what that means, but it's low. And as soon as I got under there, and that bus started rolling. There was no reason for it to roll. We were not on a hill. It had been sitting on these blocks for probably 10 minutes. And when I laid down there, that bus rolled forward, and I started rolling out of the way. And it came down on my chest. Amen. I kept thinking, man, this thing weighs 34,000 pounds. What if it would have been something heavy? And I tried to get out of the way, and that thing pinned me behind the tow truck and messed me up a little bit. And my wife standing there walking a dog, different dog, and she sees my leg sticking out, and this just happening, and she's pretty sure she's going to be following a hearse back to Ohio. Amen. And I'll tell you what, I didn't die. And I got out of there a little bit. I was banged up, crushed, really. And the guy, the tow truck driver, he's scared to death. And he says, are you all right? I can't breathe hardly. And I said, if I would have died, I'd be in heaven. And I tried to tell him about Jesus Christ. Amen. So, amen. I survived that ordeal. The next day, I get a phone call. I did go to the emergency finally. She made me. And the next day, we get a phone call from Iraq. Now, our son was on his first tour in Iraq with the 82nd Airborne Division. And he did 3 tours there. Amen. In combat. So he calls the next day from Iraq. I am stove up. Might have been 2 days because I can talk now. I am stove up, can't move, canceling meetings on the Navajo reservation, 3 meetings over there, on our way to California. Everybody's gracious. Everybody's, you know, make an exception that, you know, I'm banged up. And he calls. Now, think about that. In 2003, in Amarillo, Texas, you'd be lucky if you could get a cell phone signal from Ohio. And he calls, clears a bell from Iraq. And I said, what's going on, Pete? He said, well, he was in a Humvee carrying 75 pounds of diesel fuel and 400 pounds of explosives. He's a combat engineer. And they were on a road outside of Baghdad. Guy stood up in the distance with fired an RPG. 4 guys in the truck. And they watched that thing come. Bam! Hit dead center in the grill and did not explode. And he's calling to tell us that. And they took it out, blew it up. He knew why he was alive because of a praying mother. Yeah. Amen. And I tell my wife that. Here we are. And it happened 2 days before. It happened all on the same day. So she knows that God spared her husband and her son the same day. And there was no time to make a call, get on a prayer chain. We know why. People pray for us. Thank you for praying for us. That's called preemptive prayer. Amen. In 06, that bus caught on fire. Daughter's sleep on top of the motor, and motor caught on fire. Mom got her out of there. We got pulled over. Bus burned up. Amen. We were all fine. I stood there on the side of the road, and I said to the Lord, that thing, I mean, we lost $100,000 in, I don't know, 20 minutes. And I said, Lord, that's your bus. You could stop this. And he didn't. And I had a real spiritual moment. I said, Lord, this is your ministry. This is your business. What you take, you take. But what you leave us with, we'll go on with. And I am watching this thing burn, and I look over to the side, and there's my wife and 2 daughters and that little dog. And I'll tell you what, the Holy Spirit impressed me with this right here. I left you them, and none of us got hurt. And we started rejoicing and towed that thing to the scrapper and got an old Winnebago, and that was 17, 18 years ago. Amen. Thank God for people that pray. Let me see, 4 years ago in Sioux City, Iowa, I was walking across the parking lot. A tow truck was sitting there, a regular tow truck, not a semi. And I got behind it. He started it up, revved the motor. I yelled, hey. He floored it. I dove out of the way. My wife sees this all in the rearview mirror. She thinks I'm under it. When he got out of the way, I was laying over in the grass. Banged up, trying to play the man, pretend like I didn't get hurt. Amen. That's God taking care of us. That's an answer to prayer. We're not safe on the road because of my skill as a driver. We're not safe on the road because of all this experience. I'm not taking credit for any of that. We're able to do what we do out there because of you. We come, we make friends, we sit around, we fellowship. But hey, as brothers and sisters in Christ, we pray for you and we thank you for praying for us. We thank God for prayer warriors. Amen. Now, they're often unknown soldiers, but guaranteed they're well known to God. He recognizes their voice when they go to the throne of grace. It's important. Let me ask you something. Does he recognize your voice? Who's that again? I haven't heard that voice in a while. All right, number two. Number two is, take your Bible, go to Luke 17, because you're looking at me funny, so I got to give you something to do. Luke 17, look at verse 10. And the Lord speaking, he said, so likewise ye, when ye shall have done all those things which are commanded you, say, we are unprofitable servants. We have done that which was our duty to do. Thank God for Christians that look at serving God in the local church as just doing their duty. They don't have to be applauded or awarded or recognized. They're just doing, I call them patient workers. Thank God for patient workers. We're talking about unknown soldiers. And patient workers are faithful members who just do what needs to be done. You know, the non-glamorous jobs that nobody wants to do, but everybody expects to be done. Somebody's doing them. Amen. And we notice. I thank God for those who take Romans 12, verse 1 seriously. Paul said, I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable to God, which is your reasonable service. Boy, Susan and I get to rub shoulders with patient workers in little churches like this all across America. We get a glimpse of the body of Christ that, you know, you're not going to get at a camp meeting or a blowout. Amen. And my hat's off to the patient workers, Sunday school teachers. You know, Sunday school teachers got to put time in preparing a lesson just like a preacher does. Amen. We're not the crowd that's just reading off some flyer that came in the mail from the convention.
Amen.
Amen. Sunday school teachers study that stuff, whatever it is, at whatever level, so that they can not only teach their class, but to answer questions. Amen. And junior church, amen. You guys should get a Purple Heart. Amen. People that do the maintenance in a church, do the cleaning. Every job is important.
Amen.
Amen. Although the preacher gets most of the recognition when things go right. By the same token, he's the one that gets all the blame when things go wrong, too. Nothing is going on, and he's made it clear, nothing's going on in a church without you guys, without patient workers. And though they usually get
we're going to have lavatory cleaning day next Sunday, and you have a flower to everybody that cleans toilet.
I've never heard of that. Don't start that. Amen. You do not hear that from me. But I want to recognize the unknown soldiers that keep this thing moving. Amen. God knows exactly who they are. God knows exactly who they're not. We travel around and sometimes we get people kind of present themselves to us like they're something they're not. Let me explain something to you. The pastors I preach for, I have a very close relationship with. So don't come and try to fill me up with a bunch of baloney and think that I'm not going to be talking to him. I've been places and I say, boy, that one couple, they really sound like, he said, brother, they haven't been here since you were here last time. And we don't know. And we think they're pillars of the congregation. Amen. That's not what I'm talking about. God knows all about that. Amen. And though the patient workers usually get little recognition or thanks, I'm thanking you. Amen? There's an army of patient workers. Thank God for the prayer warriors and patient workers. Take your Bible, go to Mark chapter 5. Mark chapter 5 and verse 19, and the maniac Gadara was told this by the Lord. Mark 5:19, go home to thy friends and tell them how great things the Lord hath done for thee and hath had compassion on thee. Amen. I wrote that book. I wrote that book in answer to that verse. I said, "How am I going to reach my old crowd? They think I turned on them." And the Lord said, "Write a book." So I wrote it. I wrote one book. It's a big fat gospel tract, and it's gotten into places. 15,000 sold, I guess. Gotten into places that where I wouldn't be able to speak to my old friends. Some of them gotten saved. Amen. Some of you might have prayed for a fellow named Taco. He was the leader of the outlaws and my best friend at one time until I got saved. And then, well, I don't want to go into it, but I wrote to him for 10 years and he got saved just before he died 3 years ago. Amen. Did you pray for him? Thank you, because it pays off. Amen. Persistent witness. We had a guy in our church. His name was Greg Pritchard. He's home with the Lord now, and he was one of the guys that the Lord put with me to travel. He was saved, 6-7 months after me. He's about my age. He was a convicted drug smuggler. Hauled marijuana from California to Ohio, got busted, went to jail for a little while, got probation a little while, got saved. and spent the last 12 years of his life carrying box trucks full of Bibles and gospel tracts from Fellowship Track League to wherever containers were that were being sent to Africa and Bulgaria and Romania and the Philippines. And that's how Greg finished his life, hauling the gospel instead of dope. Amen. He was an auto body man by trade. And he renamed his body shop after he got saved. He renamed his body shop Resurrection Auto. Big sign on the road in a rough part of town. That's where we were all from. And so the Dayton Daily News wanted to do an interview. It might have been the TV station or both. I don't know. They wanted to do an interview. Why would you name Mr. Pritchard? Why would you want to name your... He said, well, Jesus Christ changed my life. He restored my life when he resurrected from the dead. And I restore cars for a living. So I just thought I'd change the name. And the gospel went out into 400,000 homes that day. Amen. So he was a little rough around the edge because he wasn't smooth and debonair like me. And so I lived right up the hill, and he'd get guys in the body shop, and everybody, there's no mistake, and something happened to him. And it wasn't a shave and a haircut and a three-piece suit. It was a changed life. That book says, therefore, if any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. Religion can't make you a new creature. Turning over a new leaf don't do it. There ain't a social program in the world. And there's things at hand to help you get victory over bad habits, but none of them make you a new creature in Christ. And I preached it one day, when you really get saved, people will notice. And people would come in and he'd say, let me tell you about Jesus. And he'd get to the place. He was not a big soul winner. He'd call me. I'm right up the hill. He'd call me. Come on down here. And boy, more than a few times, man, me and him and some old friend of his would kneel on that greasy floor in that body shop and people got saved. Amen. Then they'd come to church. Greg Pritchard was responsible for more visitors coming to our church for about a 10-year period, and some of them that stuck for years and years, than any other three people in our church. He wasn't eloquent. He wasn't a super soul winner. Amen. He wasn't a smooth talker. He was just a persistent witness. He was real. He was a real deal. That's what they need. This country needs people that are just genuine. Amen? Let me ask you, does your life testify of the life-changing power of Jesus Christ? Problem is, some of us, we fit in way too good on Monday through Saturday. So how do you know? Because I see it in churches. I see that world bleeding in. We got it backwards. We're supposed to be affecting them. They're affecting us, beloved. We're lowering the standards. We're dropping the bar. We're making excuses. We're blaming religion for rules and standards and convictions. And we're just blending right in with the world. And they see it and we don't. That ain't much of a witness. Everybody's got opinions. Amen. They got a little tight right there. It's been tight the whole night. Amen. Thank God for persistent witnesses. Let me tell you something. That's why we're still here. The Lord told us in Matthew 5, let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father, which is in heaven. All right? Still with me? Wake up. Isaiah 62, last of all. Isaiah 62. So what do we got? We got prayer warrior and patient worker and persistent witness. Isaiah 62 and verse 6. I have set watchmen upon thy walls, O Jerusalem, which shall never hold their peace day or night. Ye that make mention of the Lord, keep not silence. Yeah. I'm going to recognize some unknown soldiers that I have the privilege of working with all across the country, and they're persevering watchmen, pastors of the local churches. oftentimes. Now, I'm not talking about camp meeting headliners or the authors or the evangelists who get their names on flyers and tracts. And some of us are getting way more recognition down here than we should. I'm not talking about professional men of God. I'll go somewhere and good church is going good. And I say, well, I'm thinking about going. And I'm going, why would a man that's got a good work going? I'm not talking about that kind of pastor. I run into not very many in our crowd. I'm talking about real shepherds. That Bible says a shepherd devotes his life to the flock that God has entrusted him with. They'll lay down their life for the sheep. Amen? I know pastor friends that see people get saved and then thank God not all, but get saved and then not come. Not get victory. That is available through Lord Jesus Christ. What a heartbreak. Amen. I see pastors counsel people, give them biblical counsel, and then they reject it, and then they reap it. And you didn't want to say, I told you so, but you don't, because it breaks their heart. They see people that they prayed for and sacrificed for get crossways with them, and next thing you know, they're stabbing them in the back and spreading lies about them. That's rough stuff. That's what enduring hardness as a good soldier is about. It's not glamorous at all. Amen? But they stick. They stay in the battle. I respect that. Amen. Most of them are never known outside of the community that God has called them to. Like I say, they stay below the radar because they got their hands full. Amen. To me, they're the real heroes. And it is my privilege to work with many. Amen. Let me give you some sound advice for wrapping this up. If I was you, I would pray that nothing stupid ever gets between you and your pastor. Amen. Preaching about unknown soldiers tonight. Our nation honors them, and it said, there rests in honor and glory an American soldier known but to God. And I just wanted to remind you tonight that there's some in the spiritual service, too. Many known but to God, but isn't that enough? Amen? Did you make the list? Would you consider yourself a prayer warrior? I wouldn't claim to be. Amen? Amen? Are you a patient worker? And there's some here, obviously. Amen. And how about persistent witness? I don't know if you guys know about this, but I got a Jeep, and on Jeeps, people put ducks. They put little rubber ducks with little tags, says nice Jeep. I don't know. Somebody put one on my Jeep. And I went, well, what is this? And my wife says, we could put gospel tracks and punch a hole in them. And so her and I have put over 100 gospel tracks with little rubber ducks and Jeeps all over, well, mostly in Ohio because I was rehabbing from the shoulder. And, hey, man, it's no big deal to hand out tracks. Amen. You should be a persistent witness. You know what's wrong with some? They have decided that they've decided to settle for just being a pew warmer. This ain't the denomination for that. We need to get busy for Jesus Christ. We got a Bible. There's a war going on for the souls of men and women and boys and girls. And by all means, get in the fight. Amen. Be a good soldier for God. Let me just say this. If you're in here and you're not saved, you're who spiritual warfare is all about. Amen. And you need to come to Jesus Christ before that trumpet does blow. I'm reading a book by Bill Grady right now, and one of the chapters is The Trumpet is Out of the Case. Amen. I hope it is, man. But I know where I'm going. Do you? I mean, do you know? Not think, not hope. I run into that. If you do personal work, do you know where you're going to spend eternity? Well, I think. Wrong answer. Amen. Amen. Well, I hope. The older I get, the more things I don't know. But I know that because of this. Preacher, come on. Unknown soldier tonight. Amen.
Just go ahead and bow for a word of prayer. Again, Father, we thank you for these folks that have come out here on a Saturday afternoon. Again, I appreciate them taking time out of their schedule. Appreciate their attentiveness, Father, their enthusiasm, their singing, their just their willingness to listen to the Word of God. Father, truth of the matter is we all need to be maybe an unknown soldier. We don't need to do this Christian walk for fame or for recognition. But, Father, we have a God in heaven that we just desire to serve. Pray that you'd use each and every one of us. Give us something to do. Pray, Father, we'd be about your business. Pray that we would be about prayer for one for another. As Brother Dave mentioned and very well illustrated, Father, the necessity of praying for one for another is far greater than probably most of us realize. So help us to remember to be in prayer. We love you. Father, help us just to be pleasing in your eyes. We ask all these things now in Jesus' name. Amen.